Light is visible or not? Okay. So this one is lecture number 8, and here we will discuss in detail about a few more sequence properties of sequences and how we can take benefit of that representation. So two important applications we will talk in detail. One is to discuss about how, if you are having a set, then how we can talk about visualize the member of that set. It is very much essential to visualize the member of a set, and if you are able to visualize all the member of a set, then definitely it will be really interesting in order to talk further about that set. So one concept of set will come as a countable set. That countable set, simply we will see that if you are having a set S, then if you are able to write every member of that set in a single sequence, in terms of, that means every member we are finding a proper ordering. In such a way, we are saying that this member of the set would be first element, next one would be another, likewise. So every member of the set can be written in a single sequence. Then we will call that set would be a countable set. So here you can see that sequence concept is coming, that we are writing every member of the set in a single sequence, in the form of single sequence, or I would like to. So definitely you may raise a question, I am calling it sequence. So I am saying that it would be of the form of, like, set happens to be always we write in what, always write within a curly bracket. That's where I am writing image of the sequence. Sequence, corresponding sequence would be an. I have given notation, always we represent sequence by an within a bracket. So this was, this one is the representation of sequence. This one is talking about what? It is talking about the range of the sequence. So we try to write a countable set in the form of a single sequence an in such a way s would be equal to range of the corresponding sequence, and there would be another set that we will call it uncountable set if we fail to write that given set in a form of single sequence. Then we simply will say that that set would be uncountable set, like interval and real number kind of things. Those are playing very important role in various concept of mathematics. So that's why we will see these kind of concept in today's lecture. So uncountable set, simply here you fail to represent the set into a single sequence. It is not equal to a single sequence. That is the criteria of being uncountable set. It may be union, or it may be something more than that. Okay. So coming to outline of today's lecture, we will discuss in detail first about that if silent game, and how to claim that a number would be a limit of a sequence, and further few properties of that with respect to various epsilon, how we can come up with a suitable k in order to claim that a particular number would be a limit of the given sequence. And next we will discuss about countable and uncountable set from the perspective of sequence or sequential criteria. I would like to say that sequential criteria also here in the set, in order to visualize every member of the set, sequence is playing very important role, as I mentioned. And likewise, sequence will come everywhere, whether you are just studying limit, continuity, differentiability, even integrality, everywhere sequence will come. So sequence is giving a very clear visualization of all those concepts that will come later. So first, coming in last class, I had already discussed about limit of, if you are taking a sequence, like you are defining a sequence an, where an, nth term an is actually r to the power n, where r is a any real number between 0 and 1. And we had already seen that the limit of this sequence was 0 when n tends to infinity. N tends to infinity, the limit of sequence an, it was, or simply write it r to the power n, it was 0. We had already seen that. Even you can generalize this result as well further, that if you replace r by modulus of r, modulus of r, that means here you are free to take value of r between what, between minus 1 and 1. So again you will see that limit of the sequence modulus simply call it modulus or absolute value of r, absolute value of r to the power n, it would also converge to 0. Limit of this one is also converging to 0. This one is very important kind of result, and it will help to find limit of other sequences based on this one. Okay, related to this one, is it now here one more thing is coming, that when you are taking value of r between minus 1 to here it would be 1, value of r is between minus 1 to 1, then we see that limit of this limit is approaching to 0 when n tends to infinity. Now one more criteria is that, tell me, if you are taking value of r equal to 1, what would be value of this limit? If you are taking r equal to 1, what would be value of limit? What is 1 to the power n? It is always there. So again, convergence criteria is there. There is no issue. Now, if you take r equal to minus 1, what would be? If you take r equal to minus 1, depends. I am talking about what would be limit. So you have to give the value of limit. That means if you are taking r equal to minus 1, then you are getting a sequence like n would be minus 1 to the power n. So this is your nth term. So what is this? What is the convergence? Whether it is going to converge, it is having a limit point or limit or not? So it will also, you are saying that it will oscillate between minus 1 or 1. That means there is no single number L, so that you can find all the member of the sequence within epsilon distance of this number. We are not getting such a number L. We are not getting. Okay, we are getting a here situation is like that. You will see that few members are in the epsilon neighborhood of 1, and few members infinitely many member are within epsilon neighborhood of minus 1. Okay, so that's where here you can write it like this way. Oscillatory here, oscillation, we observe oscillatory nature, oscillation. That means after n term, we will say that if you are taking odd indices, then it would fall within epsilon distance of minus 1. And if you take even indices, suffixes, then here indices we are talking minus 1 to the power n, and here coming as an index, what we call it, then those with respect to even, it will fall within epsilon neighborhood of 1. So that's why fluctuation is there. There is no single number we are getting. So simply we will say that this sequence is divergent. It is not having a limit. It is oscillatory in nature. So if a sequence is having no limit, then simply we say that that sequence is divergent. Not convergent means divergent. Simply say that. So this sequence is divergent. But here these sequences are convergent sequences. These are having unique limits. So that's why these sequences are convergent. So those things we will see in detail here. So first, let us discuss about epsilon game. So suppose here situation is coming like this way. Epsilon game, what does it say? It says that a two-player game. So player A, player A asserts that a certain number x, it would be a limit of a given sequence xn, but it is challenged by another player by giving a specific value of epsilon. this player A is saying that a certain number x is a limit point of the given sequence xn. But this statement, it is challenged by player B, that player B is saying that I am giving you epsilon with respect to this epsilon. Try to prove that x is a limit point. So what player A will do? Player A will respond by finding a suitable k. Player A have to find a suitable k based on the player what player B has provided the epsilon. So based on that, player A has to find a k such that player A will say that leaving first k minus 1 term of the sequence, rest of the sequence terms falls in the epsilon neighborhood of x. So here definitely this k would be what? It would be dependent on the epsilon provided by second player or player B. It would be a function of epsilon. So that is the thing. So epsilon is provided by player B and k is actually estimated by player A. That is the game. So that's why you can say that it is a two player game. Epsilon is given by someone and k it has to estimate has to be estimated by other player, that in order to winning. Okay, so what simply in two player game, what would be meaning of winning and losing? So those concepts we will see it here. If a player can always find a k that works always, whatever epsilon B is providing, and with respect to each epsilon, if player is coming with what we call it 1k, then in that case we say that player A wins, and hence we can say that sequence is convergent. And suppose if player is having providing one specific epsilon epsilon, with respect to that player A fails to respond, that means player A unable to find any k associated with that epsilon, then simply in that case what we will see, we will say that player B wins. Why? Because player A failed to find a suitable k with respect to given epsilon, and hence we will say that the sequence is going to divergent. Okay, and prior to that I should discuss about the same example, like last class we had discussed that if you are taking limit of a sequence r to the power n, n tends to infinity and r is between 0 to 1, and then this limit is converging to 0. Here it is r to the power, it is equal to 0, where r is between 0 and 1. So this is the, we had already seen the proof of this one. Now here we are coming with a specific value of r. Suppose we are taking 0.8, and epsilon that like player B is providing, if someone is providing epsilon to you in order to validate your that computational capacity, that epsilon is given 0.01, then you have to find a suitable k. What would be suitable k? So suitable k, just it would be it would come from this result is coming from that Archimedean property, that this k, for if you consider epsilon between 0 and 1, r between 0 and 1, then log epsilon log r both would be negative and the corresponding ratio would be positive. So with respect to this positive number, if you simplify, epsilon is given to you, r is given to you, is simply, so if you simplify, then this ratio is coming 20.6377, and with respect to this real number we can find a k from Archimedean property, that k would be what, 21, just greater than this real number. What is, which number is greater than this integer is greater than this one, just greater than that one, is 21. So k would be 21 with respect to this r and epsilon. K would be 21. Likewise, if you keep on changing epsilon, you will get different k. This is the way to visualize that play epsilon k game. Okay, now I will take one more example of convergent sequence. So here if you are taking a sequence twice of minus 1 by 2 to the power n, then we are claiming that limit of the sequence is converging to 0, limit of this sequence is converging to 0. So if you are geometrically willing to visualize this convergent sequence, how you can visualize? That means after few, that you come up with any epsilon, any epsilon that would be greater than 0 and as a small as positive real number, you will see that after this one is value of 0. Okay, after number k, you will see that most of member, you can observe that all these members, after suppose you can say that k equal to 6, k equal to 6, so k equal to 6 onward, all the member falls in a small neighborhood of 0. So how you will define neighborhood of 0? So here 0 is what? An, simply we say that an is approaching to 0. So value of 0, it will come along the vertical axis. So the neighborhood of epsilon neighborhood of 0 would be what? It would be epsilon neighborhood of 0. So this point would be, we can call it 0 plus epsilon, and this one would be 0 minus epsilon. So for a given epsilon, there exists k, that k happens to be function of epsilon, such that what we observe, it is a natural number, this k, such that we observe that all the member of a given sequence, it is near to 0, in the epsilon neighborhood of 0, for every n greater than equal to k. After leaving few terms, rest of the terms are in the epsilon neighborhood. So further, you can, if you break out to here in the form of interval, you can see that an belongs to minus epsilon and plus epsilon. Geometrically, you can visualize this one like this one. This is the longest strip is the interval minus epsilon to plus interval. So within this interval, all the number of all the terms would be here. So this one is geometrical visualization of convergence. So that means if you take any another number, likewise you can get, just like if you say that one sequence is converging to 2, then with respect to that you will get a very narrow band of that epsilon neighborhood about 2, and you will see that after leaving few first terms, rest of terms would be finally in falls in that narrow band, like this narrow band. You can make epsilon as small as possible, keep on narrowing this strip, and you will see that most of the term falls in that narrow band. So that is the geometrical visualization of convergent of a sequence. So here I should change the title here. I am taking few more things here. Suppose we are having a sequence, and if it is talking about tail of the sequence, so these are not much of important. So your tail of sequence, for a given sequence, you can define tail of sequence like this way, like XM, capital XM. It is a sequence after leaving first m term. So here this we are generally calling it tail of sequence. That means first m term we have left, after that what is remaining term is coming, through that we are defining a sequence. So I would like to highlight it here, if sequence is convergent and you are just leaving out few terms, then it is not, that one is not going to affect the convergence of that sequence. Okay, and further, if you take limit of this sequence, that limit of this sequence would be equal to limit of actual sequence, what it is given here. It is not affecting that, if your truncation of few term is not going to affect. That's why tail, we say that m tail of the given sequence, it is having the same limit what actual sequence is having. Like this way, if you take a sequence like here 1 1 by 2 1 by 3 1 by 4, okay, it will keep on going. So this one is your sequence, sorry, call it x. Then what would be x3? What would be x3? Anyone? What would be x3? That means we are just truncating first three terms. That means it will start from 1 by 4, 1 by 5, and it will go on. So here what would be, what would be nth term? Nth term would be 3 plus n, and it will go. So that is the concept. That is the concept. That means we just left out first three terms, after that remaining. So tell me whether convergent, what is the limit of this sequence? This sequence, in, if I write in the short form, it would be sequence with nth term 1 by n. So what is limit of this sequence x, where it will converge? Any idea? Zero. Very nice. And now if you are willing to write this sequence in short form, what would be representation? Okay, there is a space issue. I am writing it here. 1 by 3 plus n. So where it will converge? 1 by 3 plus n, where it will converge? Again, it will convert to 0. So do you see that is there any difference between limit of this set and limit of this tail, mth tail sequence? We don't see. Both are equal. Actually I have taken this one. Why? Because it will find application in Taylor's theorem. In remainder after n term there would be, so you will see that it will have application there. So that's why I have taken it. Now this one is a very interesting kind of result. It is helping to find limit of a given sequence. What does it say? That suppose we are having a sequence xn of real number and a real number x. So if there we are having another sequence an, this one is, we are having sequence xn and we are having a real number x. Right now we don't know x is a limit of xn or not, but again apart from that we are having information that an is a sequence of positive real number. Remember that it is talking about an is a sequence of positive real number. That means every member of this sequence is greater than 0, positive real number. Apart from that, this limit of this sequence is 0. It is converging to 0. So one example, you can say that it is 1 by n. If you take n equal to 1 by n, definitely you will see that 1 by n is greater than 0 for n coming from natural number. Okay, so that can, n is 1 by n kind of sequence, simply you can say that. And suppose there is a constant c and some natural number m, such that what we observe, xn, absolute value of xn minus x is bounded by c times an after all n greater than equal to m, then simply we can claim that limit of this sequence is, actually it would be equal to x. Limit of this sequence would be equal to x. So what information is given to us? We are having, what is the limit of this one? It is sequence of all positive real number. Okay, and an is converging to 0 and c is any positive constant. So this one is given to us. So convergence of this to 0, and it simply implies that this sequence is converging, going to converge to x. Okay, that is the, so it is also helping in order to find limit of a very interesting kind of sequence. I want to go in detail of proof of this one. Just I will take benefit of this result in order to find limit of this given sequence. So we are having a sequence 1 by an plus 1. So here remember that if you are willing to prove this theorem, you have to deal with epsilon k game. You have to play with epsilon k game, then you will able to establish this result. Okay, and what is happening, that definitely this one is a true result. Next, if you are willing to prove any theorem based on this one, you don't have to proceed with epsilon k game. Okay, what you do directly by utilizing this result, That means if in a given sequence, call it xn, and in that given sequence, just you have to find a suitable sequence of positive real number which is converging to zero, and you have to prove that just anyhow this kind of inequality, you have to come up with this kind of inequality, then easily you can claim that xn is having a limit easily. So same here, target we are having 1 by an plus 1. We won't apply epsilon k game here, so we will just take benefit of this theorem. So we know that we are claiming that 0 is the limit of this one. So how we can establish that? So if you take difference, absolute value of difference of 1 by an plus 1 with 0, and if you simplify, we know that here condition is given, a is greater than 0, n is also greater than 0 because it is a natural number. So product of two positive number happens to be again positive. So that's why 1 by an plus 1 minus 0, it would be just 1 by an plus 1, and it is a positive number, so modulus of this one would be equal to 1 by an plus 1. And if you see closely, then you can see that this quantity is less than 1 by an. And further, if you take 1 by a as a comma, we know that a is greater than 0, so 1 by a would be also greater than 0, and call that number as a c, given constant c. Okay, so this one is c, and we can easily observe that this modulus of this sequence is less than c times 1 by n, and we are already having idea that limit of 1 by n is converging to 0. So from here we can easily claim that this sequence is going to converge to 0. That's where limit of this sequence is equal to 0. So just one application of this we have established. So same, if someone is willing to find a limit of what we call it r to the power n, is 0, then you can, without using epsilon k game, you can establish with the help of this one, you can establish you can prove that limit would be 0. So what do you have to do? The condition is given here that r is between 0 and 1. So what you will do, that here you have to, as r is greater than 0 and less than 1, so you can say that there exists a real positive real number a, so that you can write r as 1 by a plus 1. You can able to write like this way, r equal to 1 by a plus 1. So if you try to simplify r to the power n as what it would be, it would be 1 by a plus 1 to the power n, and it will take the form of 1 by this binomial term, a plus 1 to the power n. Okay, now anyone may recall which one is greater, a plus 1 to the power n or 1 plus n to the power n? Which one is greater, whether this quantity is bigger or this quantity is bigger? Okay, let me write n in the form of power. Tell me which quantity is greater than, whether this quantity is greater than this or this quantity is greater than this. Anyone? Have a one. What? Yeah, why? Why? Yeah, it is directly coming from binomial theorem. You, everyone aware of binomial theorem. This one is what? This one is the first term, this one is the last term. In the binomial theorem, if you try to apply it, this one is the first one, this one is the last one. So if you take write a plus 1 equal to 1 plus a, due to commutative law, you can treat it like this way. So okay, so rest of term are just, we are leaving, that's why this quantity would be greater than this one. So from here easily you can imply that what will happen if this quantity is greater than this. So automatically we can say that 1 by a plus 1 to the power n, it would be dominated by 1 by 1 plus n to the power a. this quantity. And what is this? This is r to the power n, and we had already seen that 1 by an plus 1, it is going to converge to 0 when n is approaching to 0. So that's where it is going to converge to 0. This proof applies the same concept. That's where we can say that r to the power n is going to converge to 0. One minus, no, then you will be here. I am trying to apply this inequality through binomial theorem. Then minus 1 to the power n would come. That would create problem. That one is not possible. You can go to prove this concept. If r is greater, if you take r is greater than 1, in that case, what would be? You can write here. So in that case, r would be what? You write it b plus 1. B is any a small positive real number. Okay, sorry, b plus 1. Then b is a small between 0 and 1. So that negative number you can't take it here, rightly. 1 minus n, you can't take it. You will face problem. So there are various other concepts. So we will see it later. There, because as I mentioned that when r between minus 1 to 1, then again this limit is converging. Take it. It is a homework. You can establish easily through epsilon. If you are going for epsilon k game, then very fine. If you don't want to go for epsilon k game, through this result you can also establish that limit of modulus of r to the power n is converging to 0 when r is between minus 1 to 1. Also you can establish using same this result. So take that as a homework and don't go for epsilon k always. If you know this result, easily you can establish using the same concept. Here you have to just modify a little bit, then you will get that result. Okay, now here we are taking a divergent sequence that happens to be oscillatory in nature. So here we are taking sequence like minus 2, first term is minus 2, second term is 2, third term is minus 2, fourth term is 2, likewise. So if you want to give a simple form, then it is talking about twice of minus 1 to the power n. It is talking about. So we are, suppose someone is claiming that it is just, I have taken this example that how to prove that this one is a oscillatory sequence or it is a divergent sequence. So you suppose you claim that limit of this sequence is minus 2, then you have to come up with contradictory result. What is the contradictory result? So again, can just proceed with one given epsilon. That player B has given you the value of epsilon 1 with respect to this given epsilon. You can find a positive integer that would be greater than this epsilon naught itself, greater than k. Easily you can find that k would be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, whatever you want to proceed. So that would be k. Okay. Now, by selecting just all the even number which is greater than this k, that means in that case, if n is even, then n minus 1 to the power even number is what? Always equal to the 1 positive. So that's where xn would be 2. And if you try to find that modulus of difference between xn and minus 2 in order to prove that whether it is a limit of this sequence or not. So if you simplify, then we know that xn equal to 2. So 2 plus 2 equal to 4. And 4 is what? Greater than 2. So just we are seeing that getting a epsilon that one is equal to 1 with respect to that we observe that negative of negative 2. It is simply you can say that it is not less than epsilon naught. Wrong. This result is wrong. Why? Because we have already seen that this absolute value of difference of xn and minus 2, it is actually greater than 1. That means greater than epsilon. That means it is not equal to, not less than epsilon naught. So that's why we are having a contradiction. So we can say that 2 is, minus 2 is not a limit of this sequence. minus 2 is not a limit of this sequence. Likewise, also we can prove that 2 is no, also not a limit of this sequence. Where if you are taking this kind of a sequence, so again we can, if you are taking epsilon equal to 1, then you can easily find a natural number k which would be greater than k, and if you take odd number with respect to that, here replace 0 or 0 by minus 2. This same sequence I am discussing about minus 2. So if you are taking odd number, then 2 times minus 1 to the power odd, it would be minus 2. That's why xn would be minus 2. And if you simplify again, you see that this inequality is false. This inequality is false. It is actually not less than epsilon 1. Epsilon 1 is what? 1. It is false. So due to that, we say that 2 is not a limit of this sequence. So simply we can say that this set is not having any limit, having no limit. Okay, now next, this one is important part of this lecture. It will come various in various perspective, and I hope that you all will understand this in a better way in order to get maximum application of this countable set and uncountable set what I am discussing. So what is countable set? So if we are having a set, suppose call it S, then if there exists a bijection between set S and set of natural number, generally that we denote it by N, then we will say this set S is a countable set. It is a countable set. That means we need to, yes, any question? Okay, if there is a bijection between set of natural number to S, if it is a bijection, then also we can talk about inverse of that rule. Inverse of that rule also exists. If you don't have any question, just switch off your microphone. Otherwise, just ask a genuine question. So if a function is bijection, then definitely inverse will also exist, and inverse will be also a bijection. So that's why if there is a bijection between set and the natural number, that's why between word I have used. It is from both sides. Okay, so I was here talking about countable set. That means you need to get a bijection with natural number of the given set. Then we will say that set is a countable set. For example, like if you take there is a set omega and there are various points. So if you are able to put those points of the set in a proper sequential order, that this you are saying that first term, this second member, third member, fourth member, fifth member, sixth member, seventh member, eighth member, ninth member, tenth member, 11th member. Likewise, you keep on going. That means you are able to write all the element of this set omega in a single sequence. Then we say that the given set, it is a countable set. So what are the example of countable set? So smartly you have to select a sequence, single sequence. So like if you take positive integers, so if you take positive integers, then always you will find a sequence which is defined from set of natural number to positive integer, such that sequence xn, it would be given by an, xn equal to an. Always you can find one-one correspondence. That means if you it is a very simple kind of example, int map, you can say that. So suppose here natural number are here, positive integers are coming 1, 2, 3, 4, and here natural number coming 1, 2, 3, 4, likewise. So this one is the line with respect to natural number, this one is the line with respect to positive integer. So easily you can say that 1 is mapped to 1, 2 is mapped to 2, 3 is mapped to 3, 4 is mapped to 4. So 1-1 correspondence, easily you can say that. So that's why a set of positive integer, it is countable in nature. Now another trick, if you take integers, so how you can define integer and how you can find a bijection from set of natural number to integer? Anyone would like to suggest How you can find bijection from set of natural number to integer? So suppose this one is set of natural number and above one is set of integers. So here integers means it is having 0, even positive integers 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, then minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. This one is coming with respect to integers and lower one is with respect to natural numbers. So natural number is having members 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, likewise. So how we can find 1-1 correspondence? Anyone? So find a correspondence like this way. Suppose natural number 2 has been mapped to 1, natural number 3 has been mapped to minus 1, natural number 4 has been mapped to 2, natural number 5 has been mapped to minus 2, natural number 6 has been mapped to 3, natural number 7, if you take it here, it has been mapped to minus 3. So you can see that this kind of correspondence is 1-1 correspondence. So in likewise, every natural number will be mapped to some integer. So this correspondence is 1-1 correspondence. Actually, you can see that. So here you want to get an explicit form of xn. Remember that there would be a single sequence. What is that xn? So that xn, you can write, define it like this way. Xn would be n by 2 when the natural number n is even. If you are taking a even natural number, then divide it by 2, then where it will map to positive integer. Okay, if you take odd natural number and you subtract minus 1 from that and divide by 2, after that take negative, then it will map to negative integers. Okay, and if you take natural number 1, that is going to map to 0. So you can say that it is a single sequence. It is a single sequence. It is defined in such a way that this, under this sequence, n is mapped to z, and this sequence is invertible. It is a bijective and hence invertible. What is the inverse of this sequence? Inverse, you can define it like this way. So f inverse, it would be defined from z to n. Z to n. That means it says that all the positive integer has been mapped to even numbers. Even numbers, all the negative integers has been mapped to odd numbers, and 0 has been mapped to 1. 0 has been mapped to 1. So this is. So if someone is saying that positive integer or negative integer, there is no such a positive number or negative number. Generally, in case of natural number, we are defining positive number or generally in case of natural number, we are defining odd number or even number. It is not like that in everywhere. So in number theory, there is a very interesting kind of course in number theory. When we try to study about integer in detail, just read one part of that only read positive integer and enhanced positive integer is what? It is a set of natural number. So there, in that case, we are defining odd number or even number. So only in case of natural, we are defining. The rest of things are very much implied. Okay, so that's way we are defining like this way. So easily you can see that there is a proper bijection between set of natural number and set of integers, vice versa. Anyone would like to suggest that can we find bijection between set of natural number and n cross n? Another question is coming that can we find a bijection between n cross n to n? And we have already seen that it is a countable set. Why? Through identity map, we can always find a bijection. Okay, we had already seen that xn equal to n. Okay, next question is coming that can you find bijection between n cross n to n? Anyone? Okay, this concept we will discuss in next class.
So